Hi, PyCon Apex. My name is Man, or you can call me just Yotin Mosamuk. And it's sadly that as a pandemic, I can present this to you and on the face-to-face as a physical. But here I am right now on the online format for the first edition for PyCon Apex. I hope you enjoy that. Today, I'm gonna walk you through about the session called Relearning Python the Right Way, which is something that's come up to my mind recently, and I hope that this will, I mean, having the some benefit for newbie that learning Python and don't know where to go, or the veteran that still want to fill in the gap what they're missing as they're learning Python in the process. So let's get started. So talk about the why relearning. So there is a three reason that why relearning is important, especially for the veteran developer like me or the newbie one. The first reason is that Python is programming is huge. There is a lot of things that I don't know, and many things that I don't know that I don't know, and it takes years and months to realize that oh, this can help me a lot. And yeah, that's the one thing. That's the reason that this talk has come up. It's really huge. The second reason for the relearning is that there's just a things, many things that I wish I did know sooner. And if I know that sooner, my life would be much easier. It can help me do the work more effectively or stuff like that. And this talk gonna cover on about that too. And there is so much thing that I learned in the past that I don't recognize it at all on at the moment. That's because the human memory is really bad. And that's happened to like many of us. Yes, including me, as I say. And that's why relearning is important to keep you learning and regain that memory from. So for this talk for today, I divide it into three parts. The first part is that I will walk you through the big picture of the Python programming languages, what the component, what it consists of, and what you should know. I think this is the main part for the talk, and I hope you learn something from this too. The second part is to practice things, and I found out that I myself sometimes I learn things ineffective way, and it really dragged me down, and I lost a will to practice things, and I lost the confidence to go on. So, in this session, I will introduce you some practice to mastery the foundation of the concept of something that you learn, and make you confidently to adapt to the unknown as you grow or learning after the foundations. And the last thing is that, as I mentioned, the human brain is really bad, and as you learn a lot, and as you can see that Python programming language is big, you need to know how to manage what you learn, how to organize things that you learn, and pick it up when you need to. I think this is the really important one too, because if you learn and you don't know how to use it, or it cannot come up in your mind when you need it, it's gonna be useless. So the last thing is, I think will help you on that too. So let's get to the first topic, right? A few months ago, I take a course on the programming language part A from Dan Grossman at the University of Washington in Coursera. And this talk is really good. It teach me about the foundation of the programming languages. And on the second week of the course, I stumble upon this slide. And this slide got me thinking, and this is originally the concept of this talk, because I didn't realize that there is a five component for the particular programming languages that make people use it. And we're gonna go through each one by one. And of course, you might not need to know all of it, but if you know all of it, like all five components, it like the slide said, it's gonna be the essential for the good developer. And not knowing them is not mean that you don't be a good developer, but of course you might be missing something that you make your life more easier. So the first thing is the syntax and semantics. For years that I confused about this term, and I mean it's really the first thing that people usually learn when learn to programming on some particular language, right? And I kind of like confused about these two terms. So the syntax is like it mean that how you gonna express thing in the language that you type on, right? Like you type in the if something or for something or how you declare variable, stuff like that. That's the syntax. And the semantic can be described how it works. For example, do you know that how the expression in the if statement is evaluate, which order is the evaluate, and how operator which one is have the more precedent than the other, right? This stuff most people learn from some books or some courses, and I like to give a shout to the Abayo Python. This is really old, but I read it around like 2010 or something, and this is the first Python book I really read it online, and it teach me how to learn Python till today. And I want to give a shout out to the writer for that too. And yeah, in the syntax and semantics, you're gonna learn like a data type, data structure, control flow, functions, module, class, stuff like that. And this is a lot of things. I'm not going to detail on each syntax or semantics, but one thing that you need to keep in mind when you're learning the syntax and semantics is that you actually know how to express what you're thinking, what the computation that's come up to your head thinking, and express it to the languages. The second thing you need to know is that you need to know that how it actually works inside it. And if you don't know how it's delivered inside it, it's gonna be a problem, because you might not able to predict how the program is gonna work. Right? Okay, so two things to keep in mind for the syntax and semantics. The next thing is the idiom. There is a proverb called when you go in Rome, do as a Roman does. I think it's better to expand in this particular gift, right? When you go into some town or some familiar place, you need to learn how the author do in there first, because if you're not, it's gonna be like an outlier and you're gonna look weird to doing something that you might not be appropriate from there. This concept can apply a lot to the many folks that come from the other language, especially in Thailand, that people might learn C or Pascal in the high school or the college first year, and later adapt to the Python, or you just learn Python and adapt to other languages like Java. And people tend to do things in the same way as they do in the first language they learn. For example, in this example, when you want to get the index of the list of something, you try to have like declare the variable like an index and try to increment it in the loop, right? That is some pattern that I think many people from experiencing from other languages that come to Python will do usually. And if we do it in the more Pythonic way, which is more like an idiom for Python, right? You're gonna do like using the built-in function like enumerate to get the index for some things and use it as an index without need to doing the incremental things on your own. That's one example. Another example is kind of more general, is that if you come from like a C Thai language or something, you're gonna familiar with the like a read method from opening files, and it read and it seeks to the files, and when you finish, it's gonna close the files. That's like a normal pattern when you come from the from the other languages, and this is really like dangerous in Python because you can leave the file open if the code is get error in the middle of the reading, like on the example that if you divide by zero, you're gonna get the zero division error exception throwing, and the file is not closed, and the memory we're gonna leak on that point of time and go on. And the more Python idiom ways or the more Pythonic way is that you need to open the file with the with statement and open it as a F file, and you read it. Even though it's happened to throwing the exception in the middle of the file open, it will close the file for you. That is the more Pythonic ways. So if there is one thing that I learned through the year from the idiom is that it takes year to recognize this particular patterns, and luckily a few years ago there's a tool Python that when I look back at it and I go through the books, I found out that this pattern I know through the year is already packed in this book. The first book I like to mention is the Python Trick, the book from the Embedder and the Real Python team. This really are some books for introduce you the Python idiom and how the people usually write in Python. And I learned that many stuff that I learned through the year is already packed on this book. And I throw this to many of the junior in my team to start learning how to write the idiomatic Python from there. The other book that I like to mention is that it's really old, but it's got the second edition. Recently, it's the Effective Python, and it's kind of the same idea that it teaches you how to write a more idiomatic Python in general. And the second edition is covering to the more modern Python version. So I want you to like to check it out if you want to start to learn for the idiom in Python. Next thing is the library, and Python is named for like a really big ecosystem, right? From web development, machine learning, NLP, or IoT, as you can see the author section in the Python APEC today. And when talking about library in Python, there is like three things that I hope that you need to understand first. The first thing first is that you need to know how to work with pip and virtualenv. I have taught many classes and people working on the Python and their own, and they get stuck with the pip and virtualenv concept because Python is really old, right? I mean, it's not gonna install the package right away that many modern language did in the present days. And you need to know, you might not need to know exactly how the Unix work, but you need to know how the pips work and virtualenv work, and how to create that, how to pin the packages, stuff like that, how to solve the problem when the pip gets stuck or something. That's the first place I think that is probably need to learn when you talking about the library. The second thing is that as the Python is huge and there is a lot of package, it's really hard to find the package that it might be able to suit for you. For example, if I want to doing the like on the left that I want to like do a progress bar something, I don't know. I have no idea which package to start. And one particular this GitHub repository is that it's called Awesome Python, and it's a cute list that group the Python package in the category. And I found a library like TQDM that doing the like a progress bar really easily there, and many stuff that I might not really want at the time, but I know where to find the stuff. For example, if I want to find the logging, I just browsing in there, and yeah, there's a few logging library that I can use of, and it's like it's more popular and it's recognizable and usable from the author developer as well. And the last thing for the library that I want you to keep in mind is that there is a few years recently, there is a attack from the hacker. It's called like a typo squatting attack. It means that if you typing the package name, typo error recently. For example, as you can see in the list, like Django, that you missing the n, or you substitute with the j or stuff like that, you miss typo. Eventually, it able to install it, but it will install the malware package that might be look like Django, but it's packed with the harmful code or the malware that hacker is really sneak into that. And it's really dangerous because it attack the like infrastructure for Python. But I think it's luckily that the PyPI team, I want to shout on them that they're taking this serious, and many packages that I list on the right side is already taken down from the PyPI, so you might not install it. But that is something that I want you to keep in mind to check your typo correctly, because this thing happen every day. So it might not come to you one day, and yeah. And it's really harmful to your code. The last thing is the tools. And this topic is really close to the library because it's come from the same place, right? It's the PyPI. But when talking about tools, there's three things that I want to talk about. The first thing is the repo. Python has done a really good job to take the repo, the Python IDLE, which is a Python Integrated Development and Learning Environment, packed with the language that you install on the many platform, right? And if you're learning to use this effectively, it's gonna help you a lot. And it's really more lucky than those who don't have the repo in their languages. And I myself, as a veteran developer, I still using that every day to experiment the idea, a short idea, and I want to see the result immediately. And it can be doing more other than just experiment the idea. It can like help you go through the document or stuff like that too. And you might want to really take time to learning how to use this to help you like developing more easily. Right, that's the first thing for the tool. And the second thing is that when you learn to program, you might expose to the concept of the print, right? That's as a repo say that you need to print to evaluate the variable. And I learned this a second year as a professional software engineer that you can use the debugger, because Python packed with the debugger called PDB. And it's more same idea as GNU debugger is used in the C or other languages, that you can put the snippet of code like in the line 3 that you see. I put the import pdb.setTrace, and when you actually run the program on the repo or stop on the things, it will stop on the breakpoint, and it at that point you can see the actual state of the program that clearly running, and it really helps you a lot. It's not just like a repo that you can experiment idea, but you can see the actual state that program run. And I see that in the web framework like a Django or Flask, there is a really good integrate to this that to help you debug the problem when you having a problem with the state in the program and you don't know how to like reproduce it. I think it's really help a lot. And the last thing, and if you want to learn more about the PDB, I let you to like check it out on the PyCon like 19, PyCon US 19, and the talk like talk name Goodbye Pin Hello Debugger from Nina Scarango. That's really good talk for the introduce you to the PDB and the debugger in Python. I think that's really good talk. And the last tools I want you to know is that when you write the Python code, it's easier to write a like code that really unreadable and not following the coding standard way. And to to force it into the team, like to make it more easy when you doing code review using a tool like a flake page will make flake edge will force you to know which part of the code is not following the coding style rule. And I using that in a lot of my team. Also, when you're using Python and you export to the concept of the modular programming, you using a lot of the third-party package, you may have a problem with the import statement. People might not think this is important, but for me, it's quite important because it's really like a structure of what your program actually do, and it's easier to browse the code. So there's a tool that call isort, and it will sort the import in the particular file or project for you, and you just config which the style that you want to import. For example, if you having a Django project, you can just import like a standard lib and Django and the third party, and then your application packages as in this order, it will help you sort through the code more easily. And the last thing I really like to explore to you is that it's called a formatter. A formatter is the tool that will help to structureize the code in the more proper coding style. And for example, it follow the PEP8. And for years that there is a lot of the Python formatter out there, like a YAPF or PyFormatter, stuff like that. And for recent year, I found out that many people tend to settle on the black, which is the latest formatter that people tend to use it recently. And I think you might want to check it out. It gonna completely help you to not think about the coding style much for these three tools, and you can focus more on the problem that you are working on. So I think that's the five core for the programming languages like syntax and semantics, idiom, and library and tools. And I hope you learn that this component is which one is you lacking of, and you might want to start to learning it. And when talking about learning it, and you might want to check out the method that help you more confident on the foundation, which I will introduce next, which is called Ashuhari. Ashuhari is come from the Japanese martial arts term to practice, to mastery on some things. It divided to three parts. First is the Shu, that you learning to follow the rule exactly line by line to get the grasp of the fundamental. For example, if you learn to Python, you might follow the tutorial line by line exactly, and you need to type it by yourself, not just copying the code. That's the Shu step. You need to learn exactly how it works and how to do it exactly. That's the first step. And the next step is once you are master the fundamental and you know exactly how to tie it, how to learn it, how to do it as a fundamentally, you need to start to adapt what you learn into your situation. Of, for example, if you learn from the course on the video, you might want to start to adapt it into your private projects, right? Or your work projects. And on this step, you might asking yourself the question, why you are doing what are you doing? Why you need to doing this way? And many of the parts that you learn on the Shu step might not come up with the question when you learn, but when you adapt by yourself, you just need to like a improvise thing to make it work with you, right? That's the question which is happening and it's generating. And you might start to experiment things on this step and discuss with the more knowledge on that particular topic to learn. And the next stage is the RIP. It is when you start learning from your experience, right? And you start questioning and your experience is come up, and at this point you will start to create a technique on your own. And this thing is like a, it's gonna be like a your your technique on your own that you adapt a many of knowledge together to create the technique that solve your problem at that point. This might not sound easily. Let me take the example story, which is called the exit stack story that I come up with, that I experienced with myself. A long time ago, when I learned to writing the unit test, and I found out that there is a things that we cannot writing the test exactly and make it work exactly. So I learned to using the patch, which is like a Mockingbird in the Python, and I learned that to using the patch to mocking the random stuff or the time. I need to use the patch decorator, and I need to point out that to the particular function that is generating the random value, and I using the patch decorator at the top of the test case. This I learned this technique, and I using this a lot. And after the time goes by, I start to notice that when I mocking the many things at once, the test case might come up with the five patch decorator on top of it. And for me, I think is that it's causing the readability to lower, because you might find just the patch everywhere, and it's really hard to identify which test case is really using on. This way, I start to ask myself a question: is there any better way to patch? Is there any better way to putting the patch inside the test case itself so that we can see the test method more easily? That's when the hard step I arrived, you know, because I really confident with the patch, right? And I understand how it works, and I want to take it more like a more proper way and more make sense. So I start to learning how patch work more deeply, and found that I can use the patch inside the test case with the with statement, and I doing the same thing, and I come up with this practice is that using the patch with the with statement, and on a Python older version, not in the 3.10 recently, you need to doing the with nested with if you want to do a two context with it. I achieve the same thing, right? I achieve the same things. I can patch the same things inside the test case, but again, it's happened to happen the generating the new problem on that. So I start to dig in how the bit work, and that is when the restate that I arrived at already, which is I need to discover how the width work, and how to using the multiple context at once, and using that knowledge with the knowledge that I know, which is how to patch inside the function, and I come up with the exit stack, which is the package to make you able to use the multiple context at once. And I using this practice a lot in the Python 3.6, 3.7, 3.8, and so on, until recently that Python 3.10 having a ability to use the with the multiple statement more easily without using the exit stack. And that's the exit stack story. You can see that I need to learn the fundamental of the patch, how to write unit test with the mock with patch first, right? And after I really understand how it works, I start to questioning how to make it better, how to make it more make sense for me, that showing the test case more clearly. And then I using multiple knowledge, knowledge with statement combined with the knowledge using patch inside the function itself as a context to generate my own technique, which is using the exit stack to mock the multiple things in the with statement without losing the indentation, which is really more important for readability, right? Yeah, that's the exit stack story. And when you learning a lot like you know the big picture now, right? And you know how to learn it using the Shuhari ways, and it might come up to you that you might losing the memory on what you learned a few months ago, because human memory is terrible, right? And there's a technique that I use since I was in college, that to make the mark on what you learn, you need to like share it to someone. Share it some way, right? Like to learn is to share, and to share it, you might just telling to someone, having your own like an internal session in your company or friends. But I think it doesn't matter which way you want. You can just tweet it. I think that's the easiest way to share the knowledge and to like keep the knowledge in yourself too. And another technique is more proper way, just writing the blog post. I think it's more organizing way. And another thing is to having a conference talk like this like I'm talking to you at the moment. When you sharing the stuff to other people, there's a two things that come up to your head. Once, you need to know how to explain it, right? You need to know how author gonna learn it on what you learn. So you need to organize it and explain it in the way that you understand, so that people would understand what you understand. That is the way, that the same way as the computer is the refragment itself, is to like organize things to it more properly. And when you organize things properly, it's easier to learn stuff from there. But what if you are introvert like me, but you got so much to share, and you may not want to like expose to author, right? There is a technique I developed in myself. It's called a Learn Today method. In Learn Today method, there is a two thing that you need to follow. The first thing is that when you learn something, you need to explain what you learn in the same way as you explain to author. But maybe in a short format, and mostly I prefer write, right? And you need to write it down on the calendar at the same day. And when you write it down, it is the same way as you explain to the author, right? You need to explain it to your future self that how you understand this problem. The next thing for the Learn Today method is that once you start to storing the knowledge in your calendar, the knowledge will start to have a momentum. And as the author, I think most of the people do, is that when you have a momentum, you might want to keep the momentum rolling, and this can cause you to keep your learning experience more like more stable, and you wish to learn more because you having a momentum. And another benefit from here is that if you want to look up how to do things that you once learned before, you can look up in your calendar too. And I think that's the way to, for me, it's helped me a lot to gain. I remember that, for example, I remember to learning this like a years ago on the like a May. I look up on the May calendar and I found, it's already there. Something like that is helped me a lot to gain the knowledge that I might maybe forgetting what it actually do. But people memory with time is really best. And I think that's it for my talk. I think I will come up with the key takeaway from this talk for three things. The first thing is that there are five components when you're learning the programming language, like the syntax, the semantics, the idiom, the library, and the tool. If you're missing the sum of this component, might not make you be a bad programmer, but if you having know five components and you practice it regularly and learn to master it, it will help you and prevent you to do the weird and possible ineffective things when you solving the problem when you're programming. The second thing that I want you to take away is that to mastery on the particular things, there is no shortcut, and it might take time to learn something, So when you learn something, keep reflecting yourself which state you are in a Chuhari model. You might simulate you as a third person then looking to yourselves and see how do you confident on the particular topic before going to more advanced and to adapt. Without this, you might end up adapting but you not exactly understand how it works and might end up in the problem you might cannot solve, for example. The last thing is that always share what you learn. It can be simple tweet, blog or method like learn today. Because when you share, it's organizing your memory and it helps you push the momentum you learn so that you can keep learning on the next two. And I think that's conclude with my talk. And thank you for watching to this point. And if you have any questions, you can contact me with the Twitter at Yotunic or see you around in the conference. Thank you. Bye.
Okay, welcome everyone to Q&A live session. We are now with Man, Yotin. So he gave a talk about relearning, right, in computer like programming. So for those who have questions, you can leave a message or you can just leave question or you can raise your hand. We can just allow you to ask question to our speaker. Okay. So first of all, after watching your talk, I feel like to me it's very good. Like you quite a bit, very humble and continue learning. So can you tell us a little bit about your experience, like the first time that you start coding program, and now you are very expert now. What is different?
So the history is like I start to program around like in the junior high school, and the first language is C++, and at that time I just want to learn to code. But then I moved back around to like infrastructure stuff, the Linux, Unix stuff like that, and back to program around like in my university where I just decided to be like a developer. And I think the main difference from what I just start to learn and being a senior developer now is that you tend to think more about the how you code affect to the author. And it was fun in the other way around. For example, when you just start learn to code, it's just fun to like you create a program, you achieve the things and you solve the problem. But clearly as a developer in the team at as a profession, it's more fun to create a software that is maintainable and it can grow with the team and it can be used with the real user in the business.
Oh, thank you so much. You also like in your talk, right? You also mentioned about make code clean, right?
Yeah,
like
yeah.
In Python. And why is this important to keep your code clean and like understandable?
To be honest, it's like because the code it's just a medium to explain with the author and to explain to the computer that how you think and how the problem you want to solve in the business, right? And it's quite important that you need to write the code that in the way the human is understandable and you understandable and your future self is understandable and also the author in your team can understandable in the long way so that they can improve it or extend it in the future. I think that's the important part, which is I think is the main part for the software engineering topics.
Thank you. So that is good, right? So that everyone in the team can understand the same thing or have like the same standard. And so like you talk about like you to like do programming is have about like foundation things, right? That you need to know, like syntax, yeah. Semantic or something. So for you, I think everything, like every part is important. For you, which one is like more like you need to like emphasize, you need to focus more?
I think if from my experience recently, I think one thing is it's quite important and people not forgetting much is the idiom part of the language, because everyone can learn to program, right? Everyone can just read a book, just watch the tutorial, stuff like that, but and they learn the syntax and semantic how to do stuff. But idiom is an important thing because it's actually the way the language decides how to do it. And I mentioned in the talk is that if you come from the other language and you remember how the idiom works on the other language and try to apply in the another language, it might not doing what you expected, and it might end up in the weird stuff, and it might be harder for getting the help because you're not writing in the same way as the language designed for.
Mm-hmm. So like idiom is like, so the way that like different, right? So since you're already expert like in Python, so can you tell us like things that like quite unique in Python that different than other language?
I think it's easy to grasp at the beginning. I mean, there is no like a, for example, like you need to put the semicolon to every statement at the end of the program. You don't need to worry about much on the closure, the scope of the program. But the kind of unique is that you need to understand why you need to put the program in the indentation. I found that there are so many complaints about why Python need to have like a indentation a lot and not have like a bracket to end the scope of the program. But in the other way around, I think it is a good point as a Python for the language for teaching that software engineering, because it teaches you how to write a code that can be readable at the beginning without much effort.
Mm, it's like easy to write a code also, right? So we have like some people here. Oh, then we have question. So the question is, could you share your insight on the key demand of Python in education? This is the first question. Mm-hmm. I don't know how to pronounce your name. It's a Kerr Cho, right? Okay. Yeah. Thank you for your question. Share insight on the key demands of Python in education.
I can tell on the Thailand side that previously, like in Thailand, we teach the like a C and Pascal in the university first year as the first programming language for most of the computer related course in the university. But more universities tend to switch to the Python recently, and also in the high school as well as the government is like try to put the coding stuff in the more primary educations. And for the demanding, I think it's quite huge recently because it like the private sector and the government is so demanding for the like data science and the big data stuff, you know. And it just start to explode like a few years, and people can start to look for if we want to learn the Python, when you get it. And I see that in the Thai Python community, there's a lot of like a Facebook page and online courses and a video in the YouTube that produced in the past 2 or 3 years. And there's a lot of educators out there to teach the basic stuff like a semantic and syntax, and also the framework stuff to get more people into the Python in Thailand now. So I think demand is still high today, especially in the beginner level.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. So we have next question from Kershaw also. Awesome. Okay. When and how do tutor advise the learners your relearn way?
I'm not quite sure I understand this correctly, but yes. Okay. So as I mentioned before, that they start to expose the market for the tutor and the educational to teach the Python in Thailand, and it's exactly that most of the educator and the tutor that teach Python is come from they teach another language before, and they teach in the same structure as they teach the another language. For example, they teach the like a Visual Basics before, they teach C, C sharp, .NET, stuff like that before, and they tend to do the same way with the Python. And
For me, the problem is that it's missing the main idea on the Python that the way that Python do stuff, which is the idiom. For example, like they don't do like they don't doing the more Pythonic for loop a lot. They're not doing the mentioned on the built-in and the ecosystem that Python is really good at, good one. And that is the missing part for the educator in Thailand. But as a way, I still respect how they teach. I'm not gonna devote them to change the way they teach, you know, because everyone can learn from many way around. But at some point, the learner itself need to reevaluate themselves that which part of the language they're missing, and that's this one that I can provide them that which one they are missing, and they can go with the method that I talk in the talk.
Uh-huh. Oh, can I ask more about this? For example, like if you want to learn foundation, like semantic, right? For like to understand more about the structure programming, like maybe C language is good to help to understand, like, and Python have like libraries or tool that make it easier. Do you think how to we can use the Python to teach the beginner to learn about that one?
Yeah, I think for syntax and semantic is different on the each language, right? But more the Python is help you to learn to program is that they tend to let you less worry about the sign, the symbol and stuff like that you need to declare in the syntax, and let's focus on how do you solve the problem with the if you know English, it's gonna go well in the Python.
Okay, thank you so much. So we have another question. It said, are materials for learning Python in Thai becoming more common, or are more students still learning from English language resources?
In Thai, if you go to the bookstore for the past couple of years, you will see that there's more and more Python books that in Thai. And I think that those one, even though it's right from the writer that not actually start with the Python, but it's kept the idea of the syntax and semantic very well. And if they want to learn more Python, just go to the bookstore and go or go to YouTube and search for the course. I think it's really easy for the high school student who just want to learn program to find a resource to learn Python in Thai.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Also, in your talk, you mentioned about the good way to learn is you just share to people, right? Maybe like
yes.
Do you have any like good stuff or community to recommend to everyone about Python?
In Thailand, there's a few like Facebook page. They most in Thai developer community, there's a lot of Facebook page. And people tend to write a blog post and share it to the Facebook group to promote what they learn as a general idea, or like just asking a question in the Facebook group. And Twitter is quite low usage in terms of the sharing knowledge on the programming in Thai, but I tend to see some. But the conference like this or the developer meetup in Thai, it just happened regularly and people tend to share it a lot. So.
Okay. Oh, so like how about you mentioned about what is called Shuhari, right? Shuhari.
Yeah.
How you find this method of learning, and is this how you apply it in your life?
It's just more like I learned Shuhari from the most of the software development, right? It's using the Agile methodology now, and surely it's like way of the Scrum Master coach to learn to that this thing, and it's more like a retrospective. I mean, reflect to yourself how you learn, how to understand, because it's sometimes that you go to the as a career as a consultant, you go to a new project and you don't know anything about this project. You need to evaluate yourself a lot that which part you don't know and how will you know on this particular topics, and you need to know yourself first before you can actually advise to the team or to the client that which way you should go. So you need to know yourself before. So Chuhari help a lot to understand what the inside your head and how should you put the focus on to learn.
Mm-hmm. Just reflect like yourself.
Yeah. Just mm-hmm. reflect.
I think we have about like 1 minute left. Time flies so fast. Man, you want to like leave anything to everyone before we finish our session?
Okay, so thank you for listening to my talk and thank you for going into this Q&A question. I met a lot of cool people here in this event. And if you want to catch up with me, Open Space is here up there. And I have a Facebook page. In English, it's Write Python to Scare Cow. And in Thai, it's pronounced the same way, which is Khien Ngu Hai Vua Cua. And you can catch up with me on the Twitter at Yotinix. And yeah, we'll see you if you need to talk with me more on Python. I'm more happy to talk with
Thank you so much for your talk and your time for today. And also thank you, Gatak, right, for being our moderator today also. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. And I hope you have fun with the rest of the conference. They have fun activity also. Don't forget to just join us. And thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.